Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that the flag was still there. Oh, say,
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
also with you. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, in whose name the founders of this country won liberty for themselves and for us, and lit the torch of freedom for nations then unborn, grant that we and all the people of this land may have grace to maintain our liberties in righteousness and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only be careful that you do not use your freedom as an opportunity for your lower nature. Through love, become slaves to one another, for the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free." And they answered, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be free?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Go where your best prayers take you, and clench the fists of your spirit and take it easy. Breathe deeply of the glad air and live one day at a time. Know that you are precious and learn to trust. Amen. Well, welcome to everyone. It's good to see you on this 4th of July weekend and into the week. I don't know if you noticed around town, so many people moving. It seemed like the interstate was full and the city was empty. So it's good to see all of you. We have so many people traveling in the parish, and many prayers for all who are traveling. And we have a family with us this morning. I won't point them out specifically, but welcome. They were here vacationing. They've had a death in the family. They're here worshiping before they return home. So we hope your stay with us and our pastoral care with you will be helpful this morning. And again, all kind of good things going on. You see the empty windows back here. No one stole them. Don't worry. They're out to be relighted. The new technology is way cheaper than what we used to do. They'll be back in early August, they promise, so we won't look at this very long. But lots of things going on around the cathedral, as always, many things happening. I don't know about you, but I really do love the 4th of July. I mean, I just love it. I love all things patriotic, and I just say that as a confession that if I offend you, I'm sorry. I am just so over the top, it's not even funny. But I am reminded of what John Adams, one of our great grandparents of the nation, said, that if we do things well in America, then this holiday, and think of when he said this, over 200 years ago, this holiday will be huge and will be everlasting. And he was right, wasn't he? We've done things right. We have done things well. We work on the things that we need to work on. But this is a huge holiday, and aren't we blessed with it? So we don't make any bones about it. This is part of our Anglican heritage to worship, but also respect the tradition in which we find ourselves and the countries in which we live. So I have a story for you, so I want you to do something with me for just a brief moment, to go with me back to 1935. Can you do that? We're going to go back to 1935 in America. The economy, if you remember your history, was pretty bad. People were traveling and moving all over the country for jobs and trying to get settled and find themselves again. And in particular, black people were leaving and moving. They were leaving the southern states by the millions. In fact, 6 million families would leave the South to escape the Jim Crow laws. Do you remember those? Those were the things that really kept black individuals from owning property, from voting, from having access to education. And they moved north to where they would have jobs and where those laws were not applied. And one little boy who was 5 years old got caught up in all of this history. He moved with his grandmother from Arkabutla, Mississippi, to Michigan, a land that he could only imagine. He only knew one thing. He was leaving his mother, which was just breaking him up terribly. And he was going with his father's family. His father had a good job in Michigan, and he was going there to live. That's all he knew. They packed all their belongings, climbed on a train, and started out. And this little boy, the trauma of leaving his mother was so severe that over the days that it took to reach Michigan, he developed a severe stutter, one that he kept through his childhood. But once he got to Michigan, there indeed were aunts and uncles and cousins and a life he couldn't imagine. They went to church. There was a whole blessed community of people that looked like him that were stable. World was pretty good. His father had a really good job. But he still lived with the grief of leaving his mother. But his new home helped him too. He settled in. Life was good. Plenty to eat. Their life was good together. He had a lot of fun. He went to school. And all of those kind of things were really wonderful for him. And life continued to be good, but he continued to grow in his stutter to the point that he quit talking. In fact, he quit talking for 8 years. Would not say a word. If he had to communicate, he would write down what he had to communicate with his family. And at school, he would not talk. He would only write down what he needed to do. Well, the kids, you can imagine what they thought of him. They thought that he was impaired or worse. They made fun of him, thought he was dumb or stupid. And one day, his English teacher dared him, said, "I just can't put up with it, James. You are going to talk. You're going to get up and read. Right now, you're going to read this poetry." And he got up, and this magnificent, fluid voice read this beautiful poetry. Well, the kids around him were stunned. They had no idea that he probably made the best grades in the school, that he was a voracious reader, and he had a voice to die for. And he began talking after this point. He was in high school. He graduated, a remarkable thing then for a southern boy now in Michigan. And he scored so well that there was an opportunity for him to be the first child in his family to go to college. He went to the University of Michigan. And he began studying medicine because he was very smart. And then he just did this thing. He liked to talk now. He liked to read in public. And he started messing with the theater of all things, a boy who could not talk and would not. And when he touched that, he never looked back. He left his pre-med work, went totally into theater, started taking acting lessons, started advancing quickly, getting jobs and opportunities left and right. summer stock. He got called to play King Lear in Central Park. He went on to play Othello on Broadway, continued on Broadway, won Tony Awards to movies, Roots, Field of Dreams, Coming to America. Do you know who it is? And now the clues, if you don't know, are the final ones. You heard his name, the voice of CNN, the iconic Darth Vader, and our children all know him as Mufasa. The little boy grew up to be our James Earl Jones. So, and that's a different story. But I want you to think about this with me. What an American story. Is that not an American story of all time? That a little boy would grow up with his family, seek opportunity, move, reach out, succeed, grow, become successful, become famous. And you know what? Every one of you, every person here has that story in your family somewhere. That is what binds us together. There is no one here who does not have that story. It's a different story. But in a way, it's the same story. It makes us Americans. And there are millions of those stories around us. But I want you to hear something even better. Listen to James Earl Jones. Hear his words. He said, because of the Great Migration, that shifting of all those black people, he said, I lost my voice. But I also found it. The Great Migration is responsible for all that I am grateful for in life. My family and others were reaching for some golden thing, and that gold was freedom. That gold was freedom. I don't know about you, I think his attitude is remarkable. He is free of resentment, not learnings, but free of resentment, of anger, it seems. And he is thankful. He is thankful for what he sees in this country. America, a land of opportunity and freedom. Unparalleled freedom, we know, in the history of humanity. I don't know about you, but I guess you're like me. We would all rewrite some of our history if we could. Would you not? I surely would. I would rewrite some of my personal history. I would rewrite some of our collective history. But you see, that is also America. Stories of the imperfections and attempts and struggles to get opportunity and freedom for all. It is part of who we are. I don't know about you, but I think that's why we celebrate this day in church. You can celebrate America outside of church. We celebrate it here because we understand story and our collective story and what it means. You see, our collective stories remind us that we are holding up an ideal, a powerful ideal for all of time, for freedom. The ideal that men and women are created equal. The ideal that we are created equal for the pursuit of life and liberty and just happiness. You see, freedom's not a new concept. You heard it in Scripture this morning. Paul uses the word intentionally. Jesus has questioned what he means about being free. These words in Galatians remind us it is an ancient word and an ancient bit of wisdom. You see, freedom is a dream is as old as time, and maybe it is the most precious of human commodities from the beginning to now. But listen to Paul's also part of wisdom. You were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only be careful. Do not use that freedom as an opportunity for your lower nature. Freedom has responsibility, does it not? I don't need to tell you that. I don't know more about this than you. But if we're honest, we know that the more freedom you have, the more responsibility you have. Greater freedom also implies greater responsibility. The pursuit has never been easy. It will not be easy. It is not meant to be easy. I don't know if you're aware of this. Thomas Jefferson wrote about this. He said, you know, if we wrangle and struggle and struggle and wrangle and argue and write and discuss and cuss and discuss some more, he said, we probably will keep this business alive. But I want you to hear his pithy comment. Divided we stand and united we fall. That is from Thomas Jefferson. Do you understand? He says they are competing ideas. This will not be easy. And it is a message for us today in our society. It should not be easy. And yes, sometimes we're all tired of the struggle. We're tired of the cussing and discussing. It is part of who we are. They knew it in the beginning. They probably knew it might intensify during periods of time. And of course it does. Every generation, though, is pledged to the same economy of keeping freedom alive for the next generation and for everyone within its society. You know, John Meacham is one of my favorites, probably because he was a little boy in Chattanooga when I was a deacon, and I was close to him. He grew up to be quite a human, quite a writer. Every 4th of July, I reread a book. It's American Gospel, because I think it is the seminal work about our mothers and fathers and what they thought about faith, and as best as can be discerned, how that business about their faith, their civility, and their humanity fed into developing the basic framework of America. If you've not read it, do yourself a favor. And every year I read these words, so I share them with you. Short quote. John writes this: democracy is easy. The republic is hard. Democracy is fueled by passion. The republic is founded on moderation. Democracy is loud, raucous, disorderly. The republic is quiet, cool, judicious, and that we still live in its light is the founder's most wondrous deed. And we do live in its light, do we not? It is not a small thing to know if you have traveled. I've been blessed to. Many of you traveled much more extensively. People long for what they see in America, not every part of it, but this business of freedom. They do not miss it. They do not miss it. We continue to be a light to the nations. And we're here to pray that we are worthy to hold that light. You know, we have been bequeathed a precious gift, you and I. And the gift of freedom continues to be the light that we want to share. And so it is your responsibility and mine to share it. Today, you know, we say our prayers of thanksgivings for all of the opportunity that we have, for all the freedom we have. And it is not a small thing, is it, to be reminded that our mothers and fathers that started this venture realized that it wasn't some pope or king or prince giving anybody the privilege. It was common, ordinary people like us who yearned for something larger, some dream that had never been realized in the history of humanity. Something they didn't even know existed to try to put into existence. And they did it a step at a time, a problem at a time, a failure at a time, a success at a time. And I simply ask you to consider with me, that is what we do today. There is no back. There's always forward. That's what God calls us to. God calls you and me from Sunday into Monday. We are a resurrection people. That's why we talk about freedom here, because it is alive. I don't know about you, but I can taste it, and I know when I see it. Have any of you been to the Rotunda in Washington? How many of you? Raise your hands. Have you seen the painting? So quite a few of you. I remember when I walked into the Capitol building as a young man, and I walked in and stood there and saw that magnificent painting titled The Declaration of Independence by John Trumbull. My mouth just fell open. I just stood. And what I witnessed around me was there was all this huge clamor and conversation, and as people filtered in, everybody did the same. Everyone stopped. All eyes was raised at this magnificent, gigantic, awe-inspiring painting. What's interesting, of course, as much as it is one of the great scenes of our cultural heritage, it is inaccurate. A lot. It's just fascinating when you actually read about the painting. There it is, all the men are gathered. But the doors are wrong. They didn't exist then. He's put in some different period architecture. There are no massive, beautiful, ornate curtains hanging on the walls. It was a bare, sparse room. There were no all the military and other insignia of wars and everything. That was for a latter time that was introduced. You see, it was a bare, sparse room. But do you know what he got right? He got it right 47 times. Every face of every person is a remarkable, remarkable painting of the person. When the family saw the painting, they knew exactly who their family member was. It was like having a picture of them. Do you see what he's saying? It is the men, the people who counted. They counted all 47. They all counted. And what is fascinating about it is, you see, they are identifiable. They are also then accountable. We know who they are. So I'll leave you with that. That I think on this July the 4th week, if we are to uphold the heritage, you and I will both be identifiable but accountable. Every single one of you and me. It is our job to keep this business prosperous. It is our job to continue to offer life and liberty and, praise God, the pursuit of happiness. It is our job, and yes, it is messy, but it is not impossible. And simply today in our prayers, let us pray that God will always continue to give us the wisdom, the passion, the narrative, the understanding to forbear ourselves so that we do offer this generation to generation. It is an amazing gift. We live in an amazing times, in an amazing country. Can't you taste it? It is all around us. Happy 4th. Amen.
And now let's all stand. And on page 358, let's recite together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty. let's all kneel or sit. Let's offer our prayers for the following people: Joe Bacon, Edmund Bolt, Jerry Carr, Ginger Dougherty, Jean Hawes, Kimberly Musa, Tracy Riedel, Francis Seiler, Buddy Warren, Teresa Black, Greg Clark, Beau Ewald, Joe Henshaw, Nathaniel Hester, Martha Jane Jones, Jean Mathern, Jim Owenby, Cheryl Sampson, Kevin Wall, Danielle Yeager, and you may have others. Let's pray for them now. We pray for all who serve our country in the military, especially those deployed overseas. We pray for all victims of war. And we pray for all who are being persecuted and displaced because of their faith. Let us offer thanksgiving for the flowers in the church that are given to the glory of God and in memory of Ramsey and Peggy Harb. And for the flowers in the chapel, given to the glory of God and in memory of Mary and Pete Callis and Lou and Dexter Phillips. Let us offer special prayers for these people who have died recently: Jeffrey Hazen, Joyce O'Dea, and Sandra Hall. If there are others, let's pray for them also. And now, you all have an insert in your sheet there. We'll read the Thanksgivings for National Life and prayers. Almighty God, giver of all good things, we thank you for the natural majesty and beauty of this land and for the many gifts you have so freely bestowed upon us, for our great abundance of daily food and drink, our homes and families and our friends. And now, Lord, we thank you for the men and women who have made this country strong, for the brave and courageous, for those patient in suffering and faithful in adversity, for the men and women who serve our military, and for the torch of liberty which remains lighted through their many efforts. And now, Lord, we thank you for your blessings of abundance, for our intellect which calls us into faithful reflection, for our hearts that lead us to love, for our hands which enable us to serve, and for all the health and strength bestowed upon us for work and leisure. And we give you thanks especially for today. And now, Lord, we thank you for the faith we have inherited in all its rich variety. It sustains our life, although we have often been faithless in our practice. Strengthen our efforts to blot out ignorance and prejudice, to abolish poverty and crime, and enable us to carry on the good work we have inherited. And now, Lord, we thank you for enabling us to build a community in which people may gather, pray, and worship. And this day we pray for those in need, especially anyone who is in need of our prayers. And we raise up to your eternal service and blessing those who have died and have gone on before us. And now, Lord, and now, above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience and his dying, through which he overcame death, and for the gift of your Spirit, that we may know him and make him known at all times in all places. And now, Lord,
we give you thanks.
Holy and gracious God, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen each of us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Please be seated. Hey. Or not. I love it that y'all do that, so I hate to interrupt. Let me quickly introduce, and I want you to say hello to him when you see him. You'll see a lot of him. He's not actually a cousin. We do share a name. His name is Whitney Ross. He is our new communications person, and he's an expert, and we're great and glad to have him with us. So welcome. Thank you. I thank Kristen Williams and Meg Sprouse, who worked a ton of hours along with the staff to try to look for someone to fill his position. Whitney's already on the job this morning out greeting people. Since we're not at Lakeshore, he was. He thinks of smart ideas, and he's here to help us communicate better. So if you have ideas, he's going to be talking to you. He makes himself available. He works for you, as we do, and so seek him out. He has an office here. He'll come and see you, hang out with you. A great guy and brings a lot of great talent, so thanks. Good to have you aboard.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Oh,
And now, as we remain standing, let us sing together stanzas 1 and 4 of hymn number 717. Great Thanksgiving continues on page 361.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. We we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say together, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep peace. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Our post-communion prayer is on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food, and sacrificed with body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage, love and serve you, with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And may God's blessing, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you on this day and remain with you always.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and don't move. You're ready for it, aren't you? Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Oh, thank you.